Welcome all participants to the day 4 of our series to GST Knowledge Empowerment Live webinar. Today our topic is place of supply in GST and resolution of such issues, which will be headed by CA Venugopal Gela sir. I will give you a brief introduction of the speaker. Venugopal sir is a partner of Venu and Vinay Chartered Accountants, qualified in the year 2002 by securing All India 45th rank. He is also certified information systems auditor. He has also completed various other certificate courses from ICAI, namely DISA, course on business valuation, course on internal audit, course on fraud detection, and forensic accounting. He has also completed a one-year course from IIM on data analytics and business intelligence. He is an active speaker at ICAI on GST, especially on technology and its implementation challenges. He has authored various industry-specific handbooks on GST. He has contributed to the technical guide on GST audit released by ICAI and other publication materials. He conducts workshops on filing returns with ease of automation. He has developed a lot of Excel-based free utilities on GST like JSON Reader, creating JSON files, GSTN Validator, Composition versus Regular Benefit Analysis, GST Impact Reader, Real Estate Project, Switch Decision Analysis, GST audit work paper tool, etc. He is a GST faculty for ICAI and conducted various workshops and webinars. He has been co-opted to Indirect Tax Committee of ICAI 2018-19. He is core committee member of FKCCI GST wing. He advised on technology for GST implementation and integration of accounts and returns filing utilities. His other areas of practice include design and development of internal controls and process documentation, consulting in ERP implementation and migration, management consultancy for business analysis and growth and design of management information systems. Apart from audits, he is a hands-on coding in VB.NET or Python. He also reviews database design. He conducted various workshops for corporates on use of technology, improved efficiency at work using Excel, building automated reports from accounting and financial applications. He was also behind in the development and managing of cloud applications like TaxMile, Insta Financials, and others. With this, I would like to welcome our speaker for today. And an important announcement, PPT has been given, the link has been provided in the chat box, which was not sent in the reminder mail. With this, sir, you may please start your webinar. Thank you.
Yeah. Hello, everybody. Namaste. Thank you, Akshay, for kind introduction. Participants, as Akshay mentioned, the PPT is available on your right side. If you see on the chat window, there is a link of Hiragangi Academy. The PPT can be downloaded. Of course, you can just watch the screen. You can be with me. The PPT would be available. Akshay, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So let us begin this session in understanding the need and importance of place of supply. What I'm going to cover today is the transactions of what is an interstate and intrastate, and with respect to goods, the domestic transactions and exports, and with respect to services, again, the domestic transactions and the international transaction. At each and every slide or wherever is required, I'll be discussing all the practical examples and what are the issues that are going to come and how you would be needing to deal with it. All right. So first and foremost, we've been hearing that GST is a destination-based or a consumption-based tax. Now, what do we mean by that, destination-based or the consumption-based tax? We all know that there is a proper officer, and the proper officer is going to monitor us, do the audit and assessment. So the administration is always done to the registered person by the proper officer. So the monitoring or administrating state is where the supplier is situated. But who will be enjoying the benefits of the GST? The revenue of the GST would be flowing to the state where the recipient is situated. So in the state of the recipient, the government of that would enjoy the benefit of the GST, but wherever the supplier is situated, that state would do the monitoring. So the producer states would have lot of administrations, and consumer states would have lot of benefits of GST collections. Now, this being the thing, what becomes very important is the state to which the revenue goes. And the state to which the revenue goes is purely determined on place of supply. So place of supplies is a prominent chapter in GST. Generally in GST, whenever someone refers to a section, you should all consider it as CGST Act, unless otherwise mentioned otherwise. Okay. But in today's discussion, please note, in today's discussion, whatever the section numbers I am mentioning, they are from IGST Act. So you should be referring to IGST Act whenever I am mentioning to the sections. So what is that we are going to look at is the place of supply for goods. In case of a domestic transactions, it is discussed in section 10, and import and export is dealt in section 11. When it comes to services, the supplier and the recipient, if they're in India, there is a small typo, it is supplier, it's in section 12. And when either of one party is outside India, it is dealt in section 13. So in all these transactions, what we are dealing is place of supply. Now, you might be wondering, in the first slide, I have used the word recipient because that was a generic slide just to give you an awareness, but not technically, not necessary that the recipient state is enjoying the benefits. Actually, which is the state that would enjoy the benefit is wherever the place of supply is. Now, most of the times we like maybe very casually, we think place of supply means from where I am selling. But unfortunately, under GST, the way we should read place of supply means the place where it is being consumed is the place of supply. Now, why is it very necessary in understanding the place of supply? Because place of supply is going to determine the taxation. The place of supply would determine what is the nature of taxes one would be levying. So the nature of the taxes that would be levied is determined by the place of supply. Now, if the place of supply is the same state of location of the supplier, if the place of supply is same as location of supplier, as you see here in the first one, the place of supply is same as location of supplier, then the type of tax one has to charge is CGST plus SGST. In case of UTGST, it would be UTGST. But if the location of supplier, which means the person who is selling, is not the same as the location of the receipt, if it is not same as the place of supply, if location of supplier and place of supply is different, the tax one needs to charge is IGST. That is the tax one has to charge. This is from the levy perspective. But when it comes to the recipient perspective, there is also another thing one has to be very careful of. For the credit to be eligible, wherever the location of recipient is, the place of supply should also be the same state. If the place of supply is not the same as location of recipient, that is a credit which would not be eligible for that recipient. Technically, there would be a distinct person in that state, that would be the person who is eligible for the credits. I would be discussing these issues again as we go further. Okay. There is a general rule, I'll come back. Yeah, one important thing which is there in the CGST Act and IGST Act also. At times, in the event of doubt, you have charged some tax, say IGST. But eventually it is held that it has to be CGST plus SGST. Now what happens? You will have to claim a refund of IGST which you have paid, and pay the CGST, SGST tax. Similar provisions is there in IGST Act, Section 19. So wherever a registered person who has paid in case of CGST, C plus S, but is subsequently held as IGST. Vice versa section is there in IGST Act. So what I'm referring here now, section 77 of CGST Act. However, there is no interest for such transaction. Just because I'm paying IGST after 2 years, 3 years, there is no interest going to come up for this transactions. Okay. Now, what is very important is we should understand the difference between interstate and intrastate transaction. What is an interstate transaction? What is an intrastate transaction? Section 7 of IGST Act describes what can be an interstate transaction. 7 subsection 1 deals with, if it is with regards to goods, if there is a transaction between two states, two different states, two different union territories, or one state and another union territory, then it is a interstate supply. Interstate supply means IGST, integrated goods and services tax, that needs to be levied. If it is an intrastate supply, one has to levy central goods and services tax and the respective state goods and services tax. If we are saying the rate of tax is 18%, it means 9% CGST, 9% SGST. The second thing, the supply of goods are from imported into India. Goods are coming from a place outside India to an India. They are crossing the custom frontier. Okay. It would also be treated as IGST. When it comes to the services, same like goods, if there is a transaction between two different states, two different unitary territories, or state and union territory, in that case, it shall be treated as supply in the course of interstate. Like goods imported, even if the services are imported, it would be treated as IGST transaction. Now, very important, even though you are conducting a transaction within the state, even though we are conducting a transaction within the state, say I am in the state of Karnataka, I am selling to another supplier in the state of Karnataka, but such supplier is situated in an SEZ, location, then this shall be treated as interstate. Geographically, it is within the boundary of Karnataka, but from the taxation perspective, SEZ is outside India. Whenever the supplier is located in India and the place of supply is outside India, it is treated as if it's a IGST transaction. Right? So this is the transactions to be referred as interstate. And when we are saying interstate, the levy which we have to charge is IGST. What is an intrastate? Now, initially I said the domestic transaction goods is section 10, domestic transaction services is section 12. Subject to section 10 and 12, please note, wherever location of supplier is equal to place of supply, both for goods and services it is same, then this transaction shall be treated as intrastate supply. So whenever the location of supplier is equal to place of supply, this transaction shall be treated as if it is an intrastate supply, subject to section 12 and 13. So, sir, subject to section 10 and 12, I am going to explain that. So, which means there are some exceptions to it. We will come as we go further. So, let's understand what are this. Section 10 deals with place of supply for goods in case of a domestic transaction. Let's see the first one, 10.1a. Whenever the supply is involving movement of the goods, there's a movement of the goods, then the movement could be caused by the supplier or recipient or by any other person. The movement is caused by any other person. The place of supply shall be the location of the goods at the time at which the movement of goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. Wherever it is terminating to the delivery to the recipient, that would be treated as place of supply. So whomsoever have questions, you can put your questions. We would be taking up your questions after the end of the session. Now, let me explain you this. You are here in, say, Rajasthan, and you are taking the goods to all the way to AP. There's a movement which is involved via various states it is passing through. The place of supply would be AP. One practical question which people generally ask and that comes up is where the movement happens by recipient. The supplier is located in Delhi. Supplier is not moving the goods. A customer from Mumbai is walking all the way to Delhi, picking the goods and going back to Mumbai. Now, supplier is Delhi. So the location of supplier is Delhi. Now the question that comes is, what is the place of supply? Would the place of supply be Delhi or the place of supply be Mumbai? Now you might be thinking that, okay, shopkeeper is there. I am the shopkeeper. I am just selling the goods across the counter. So my delivery is terminated. The place of supply shall be Delhi. But if you look at the provision, it clearly says the movement of the goods, whether by the supplier or by the recipient, Now, if you notice, the customer is coming all the way from Mumbai and taking the goods back to Mumbai. He is taking back the goods to the Mumbai. In this case, the movement is happening from Delhi to Mumbai through the recipient. Hence, the place of supply would be Mumbai, Maharashtra. Even though the shopkeeper is selling across the counter, the place of supply shall be Maharashtra. So the one should be very careful of this kind of transaction. Next comes a bill to and a ship to transaction. In a bill to a ship to transaction, you are the supplier. I would make an instruction to you saying that, why don't you deliver the goods to so and so place? So and so place could be my other branch, my job worker, my customer, could be any reason. I would want, instead of me taking the delivery and moving the goods there, I am requesting you to move there. So if the goods are delivered to a recipient or any other person by the supplier, if the goods are delivered by you on the instruction of the third person who may be acting on behalf of an agent or anything, before or during the movement of the goods, whether or not there is a transfer of documents of title of the goods, it is deemed the third person has received, even though you did not give me the goods, it is deemed the third person has received the goods, and the place of supply shall be the principal place of such third person. So wherever my place of business is there, that would be treated as place of supply. So there is a person in Delhi. He is calling the supplier again in Delhi, asking him to send the goods to Uttar Pradesh. So from Delhi, the goods are moving to UP. Had it been a transaction of 101A, place of supply would have been UP. But here, the person who is asking to send the goods is in Delhi. Given that he is in Delhi, if you notice, both are marked in red color. So wherever the place of business of the third person is, that would be place of supply. So again, people get confused that the place of supply will be wherever the goods are moving. That is not a right way of understanding. Whenever there is no movement of goods, so goods do not move. Whenever there is no movement, place of supply would be wherever the location of the goods at the time of delivery to the recipient. Imagine a case, you have taken something on hire purchase, and after some time, you would want to keep the goods with you. At the time of supply of goods happening, there is no movement. When the movement happened, there was no supply. I was living on rent. But you chose to keep the goods. At that time, I'm making a supply, but there is no movement. So the place of supply would be wherever the location of goods at the time of delivery to the recipient. Next, in case of assembly, sometimes say you are constructing a TV tower or something where you got to go to the site, assemble it, erect it, only then you can sell. So you may ask to sell, let's take the same example of say lift or a tower. I am coming to you asking, can you come and install a tower to me? In that case, you are not going to hand over the equipments to me. You will come to my location and you will do all the work. Whenever the installation related, assembly related happens, the place of supply would be the place of installation. Let's take the example. Say the supplier of goods is in Punjab. I have asked you to do some installation and setup of an assembly in my new location, Bihar. You are taking all the material there and you are doing erection, installation and setting it up. The place of supply will be wherever the assembly is happening. Last thing in case of domestic transaction is where the goods are supplied on board or conveyance. It could be vessel, aircraft, train or motor vehicle. The place of supply will be wherever such goods are taken on board. So the train is moving, conveyance is moving, say from West Bengal to Delhi. I may sell these goods. Take the case of books. I may carry some books or some gadget, something. I am selling it in UP, I am selling it in Delhi in the conveyance. The place of supply will be wherever it is loaded, which is West Bengal. All right. This is with regards to domestic transaction. When it comes to the export or an import transactions, which means the goods are brought from outside or goods are taken outside. In these cases, where what is the place of supply? Very simple definition, export means taking goods out of India to a place outside India. So from India, goods are going out, that is export. Import means bringing goods into India from a place outside India. So goods are coming from outside India to India, it would be an import. In case of import, place of supply is wherever the importer is. It didn't say place of supply is India. I am here in Karnataka, place of supply will be Karnataka. If I am there in Delhi, place of supply would be Delhi, but an IGST transaction. Okay. Goods exported from India. Goods have been sent from here to India. Location is outside India. We have seen interstate supply. So wherever the goods are exported, it is place of supply is outside India. Section 5 provides that IGST shall be levied on goods imported into India as per Section 3 of Customs Tariff Act. Technically, import transactions, the levy is happening under Section 3 of Customs Tariff Act. That is why if you look at the input tax credit definition, this IGST paid on imports has been specifically included because this is not a levy under GST Act. Okay. So import of goods is, say from China, goods are moving to India. So the place of supply is here in India. It is called an import transaction. Export from India, goods are moving outside India, which is say Australia. The place of supply is Australia. All right. So this is about foreign transactions. Let's look at the services. We have seen till goods. Now we will move on to services. In case of domestic transactions, Section 12 deals with the domestic transaction, which means supplier and recipient in is India. So we have to apply Section 12 only when supplier and recipient is in India. There is one general rule. There is one general rule. What is the general rule for services? If a supply is made to a registered person, it's a general rule. If a supply is made to a registered person, place of supply is location of recipient. So I am a chartered accountant practicing. Say you are one registered person. You walk into my office. You take some opinion. You have taken some consultation, some opinion. Now it's a service. Whenever a service is provided, assuming you have come all the way from Delhi to Karnataka, took that opinion. Whenever a service is provided, then the place of supply would be the location of recipient. You are from Delhi, the place of supply would become Delhi. For a moment, you are not a registered person. Let's move to other bracket. You are not a registered person. Question comes, do I know your address? If I know your address and your address is Delhi, then the place of supply will be location of recipient. You are from Delhi, that would be the place of supply. If I do not even know your address, then the place of supply would be location of the supplier. You know, sometimes this Pragati Maidan, you will have this mela of income tax return filing services. Someone would walk in and get their returns filed. So you do not know where he is belonging to, or general services are being provided. So whenever you do not know the address of the recipient, then the place of supply would be location of supplier. Please note, this is a thumb rule. 99% of the transaction for services will fit into this category. 99% of the transactions would fit into this category. Now there are exceptions. Section 3 to section 14, 12 subsection 3 to 12 subsection 14 deals with specific provisions. In these transactions, ignore the general rule, apply the specific rule. Ignore the general rule and apply the specific rule. Now, this is the one of the trickiest chapter in whole of the GST Act, because for each transaction to transaction, the place of supply changes. But the thumb rule, place of supply is location of recipient. Place of supply is location of recipient. Now, let us see the exceptions coming to it. First, with regards to immovable property. Whenever the services are related to immovable property, what do you mean by services related to immovable property? It could be directly in relation to immovable property coming up, which is services of architect, interior decorator, surveyor, etc. Or services with relating to accommodation, which is like hotel, guest, campsites, all these things. Or property renting, or undertaking construction of an immovable property, or accommodation of organizing marriage, reception, or any other matters relating to thereon, then the place of supply is location of property. So as I said in the first slide, the state which is enjoying the benefit is the recipient state. And in between, I said the right word to be used is the state which will be enjoying the benefit is wherever the place of supply is. Now let's take an example here. You are in Delhi, and assuming I run a hotel and I am here in Bangalore. You come all the way from Delhi to Bangalore for an assignment. You are staying in my hotel. You are a registered person, I am a registered person. I am providing you a supply of service, the staying, accommodation, renting services, accommodation services. At the time of checkout, if I follow the general rule 12 subsection 2, ideally the place of supply would be location of recipient, which is Delhi. I should be raising an IGST transaction. However, since 12 subsection 3 carves the exception, says the place of supply shall be location of property. So I am here in Karnataka, property is situated in Karnataka, the place of supply would be Karnataka, and I would be charging CGST plus Karnataka GST. The tax would be C plus S instead of an IGST transaction. One should be very noteful of this. And we have also seen another slide. Now the place of supply is Karnataka, location of recipient is Delhi. When both of this do not match, the recipient who is in Delhi would not be able to enjoy this credit. This credit would be a loss, because this credit belongs to the state of Karnataka. It cannot be transferred to state of Delhi. So the input tax credit benefit would be lost to the person who is there in Delhi. Another point which I would like to mention, of course, this is a little litigative subject, especially with regards to renting of property. You are in Delhi, you are in Delhi, you have a property in Noida, Uttar Pradesh. You have a property in Noida, Uttar Pradesh, and it's a commercial property which you have given it on rent. You may choose to take registration in Noida or not. You have already taken a registration in Delhi. Now, a person in Delhi has taken that on rent. Even though the person in Delhi has taken the rent, let's look at what is the place of supply, location of supplier, and what type of GST needs to be levied. Supplier is in Delhi, property is in Uttar Pradesh. When the property is in Uttar Pradesh, firstly, it would be place of supply would be Uttar Pradesh. We have seen section 7, when location of supplier and the place of supply is in two different states, then it would be an IGST transaction. So the levy would be IGST. Even though supplier and recipient are in Delhi, it becomes an IGST transaction, and the person in Delhi unfortunately will not be able to get an input tax credit of this. This input tax credit would be available to the distinct person who is there in UP. Ideally, otherwise someone in UP should have been registered. Such person, if it is billed to the recipient, that person will get the benefit. But if it is billed to a recipient in Delhi with the place of supply as UP, the input tax credit would not be available. All right. Now, in case if the property which is being constructed is coming up outside India, I am in Delhi, you are in Delhi, you have given me a contract to construct a property, say in Dubai. In such situation, the place of supply would be wherever the recipient is. Wherever the recipient is. It is not deemed as an export transaction. Again, here people make mistakes. Now, if the property is coming up in multiple locations, generally people do not read the IGST rules. IGST rules explain in the government transactions, other transactions, where there is the one common contract and between multiple states, it gives a mechanism of splitting the transaction. Even here, if the property or the real estate immobile property coming up in multiple states under single contract, then you should find a way in allocating. But each state where the immovable property is, rent would be going there. So here are some examples. KTS Builders Mumbai is constructing a factory for PLM Private Limited, who is in Kolkata, but the factory is being constructed in Delhi. So recipient Kolkata, West Bengal, supplier Mumbai, Maharashtra, and construction in Delhi. Place of supply will not be Calcutta, it would be New Delhi. A chartered accountant in New Delhi travels to Bombay for a business and stays in a hotel there. Place of supply would be Maharashtra, Mumbai. A consulting engineer in Mumbai is rendering professional services with regards to a property which is coming up in Australia. Property is coming up in Australia, but the person who has contacted it is from Bangalore, Karnataka. So the place of supply here is location of recipient, which is Karnataka. Hope it is clear. In case if you have any questions, you can put it on the chat. We will take up after the session. With regards to performance-based services, 12 subsection 4. Location where the services are actually performed. Location where the services are actually performed. What are they? Restaurant services, personal grooming, fitness, beauty treatment, health services, including cosmetic and plastic surgery. Wherever the service is performed, that would be place of supply. You might be traveling all the way from Delhi to Gurgaon or Uttar Pradesh, Noida, to have a beautiful khichdi. Now, you cannot say that, okay, I am taking that khichdi back to Delhi, I am traveling, the place of supply should be wherever I am, which is Delhi. Answer is no. the moment you eat that khichdi there, the place of supply is that wherever the restaurant is. So all the services provided by restaurant would always be C plus S, CGST plus SGST. Right? So you have to be very careful in advising the client when the invoicing needs to be done. Then it comes to training and performance appraisal. Training and performance appraisal. So I am here in Karnataka making a training to you. What is the place of supply? Now, assuming you have paid the fees to me, what is the place of supply? Now, if you are registered, the place of supply is wherever you are, the location of recipient. If you are not registered, the place of supply is where I am actually performing. If I am traveling all the way to Delhi, giving a lecture in Delhi, then the place of supply would be Delhi, which means wherever the performance is happening, that would be the place of supply. Next, with regards to an entry to an event, which could be the scientific, cultural, sports, or anything, amusement park. So the place of supply in these cases, wherever the event is held, that would be place of supply. In case of this is 12 subsection 6, which is event or entry based. The 12 subsection 7 is for the person who is conducting an event. Assuming I'm doing a trade show. The entry fees to the trade show is wherever the show is set up. But if I am the one who is setting up the whole stall, so I'm providing in terms of organizing the event and including ancillary to organizing that event. If I'm doing all that setup and providing it to a registered person, then wherever the registered person is, that is the place of supply. But if I'm providing it to a person other than registered person, then wherever the event is actually held, that would be treated. And if the event is, say, coming up in Dubai, I'm setting up a trade show for you in Dubai, then the place of supply shall be location of recipient. I am from Bangalore, you are in Delhi, I am setting up an event for you in Dubai, place of supply, both of us are in India, as per 12 subsection 7, it would be location of recipient, that is you being in Delhi. Again, the explanation is given, when the event is held in more than two states, then the consolidated amount charged for such supply of services relating to each such event. So you got to, in proportionate to a value of services, you can allocate it, and based on the contract agreement, and if nothing is there, any other reasonable basis, you can do the allocation. Next, with regards to 12 subsection 8, goods transportation services. Place of supply of service by way of transporting the goods. So I am transporting the goods. If the transportation charges is to a registered person, then the place of supply is location of such registered person. If the person is other than registered person, then the place of supply is the location at which such goods are handed over for their transportation. Imagine a situation where I am VRL, you are here in Karnataka, you are also a registered person. You are giving the goods to me, asking it to deliver it to Delhi. Or you are in Delhi, you are coming to Bangalore, you are purchasing some goods, you are giving it to me, saying that my location is Delhi, deliver it to me. In either of these cases, the place of supply is, what is the place of the registered person? If the registered person is in Karnataka, place of supply is Karnataka. If the registered person is in Delhi, the place of supply is Delhi. It doesn't matter where the goods are going. If the person who has given me the contract to deliver is not a registered person, if it is not a registered person, the place of supply is wherever the goods are given to me, wherever the goods are handed over to me, that would be the place of supply. An important point one has to note, there has been an notification which said up until 30th September 2019, where transportation of goods is to a place outside India, where transportation of goods to a place outside India, you are in Delhi, I am also in Delhi, you have asked me to transport, I am the transporter, you have asked me to ship the goods to Dubai. The rate of tax for these transactions were nil. These used to be treated as a nil rated supply all this while. Then the act got amended to make that as a kind of an export transaction. The act was amended saying that the provided where the transportation of goods is to a place outside India, the place of supply shall be the destination of such goods. Now, the place of supply is outside India. Location of supplier is in India. It becomes an IGST transaction. Unfortunately, the intention of this amendment was to give this coloration of an export. But however, this got amended in 12 subsection 8. This got amended in 12 subsection 8. It cannot fulfill the export condition because I am making the payment in local currency. And unfortunately, this being an IGST transaction, the recipient might not also get an input tax credit. So this is one proviso which has come in, and it is actually putting a lot of trouble. We, in the time to come, we have to see the remedy for this transaction. Next, passenger. We have seen the goods transportation. Let's look at passenger transportation. In case of passenger transportation services.
Venu sir.
In case of a passenger transportation services, the place of supply for passenger transportation service to a registered person, if the passenger transportation service is provided to a registered person, shall be location of such person. You might have doing the booking through IRCTC, through a travel agent, or through Red Bus, Make My Trip. Whenever you do the transaction of transportation and you provide your GST number, you are a registered person. Wherever the registered person is, the place of supply will be location of such person. But most of the times, this is an unregistered transactions this industry has. So if the service is provided to a person other than a registered person, the place of supply shall be wherever the person embarks, boards the conveyance for a continuous journey. So wherever the person is boarding, that would be place of supply. So wherever the on the conveyance you boarded, that would be treated as place of supply. Now, provided where the right to passage is given for a future use and the point of embarkation is not known at the time of issue of the right, the place of such services shall be determined under subsection 12 to subsection 12, right? So especially season tickets, right? So whenever season tickets are issued, you really don't know, and you're issuing to an unregistered person, you don't know where they are going to embark. For example, okay, hypothetically, so I have got a ticket, some season ticket from the bus wherein they allow me to travel to any bus anywhere in India. Wherever I want, I can board and come down. Today we see online transactions are going up, maybe like a swipe machine type, it would be given, which is a preloaded. As long as that card has validity, say like 1 month, 2 month, I can take any bus anywhere and things like that. So at the time of issuing the card, I do not know where do I board. So I have permission to board in multiple states and multiple places. In such situations, 12 subsection 2 would be applied. 12 subsection 2 says, if you know the address of the person, that would be place of supply. If you do not know the address of the person, then the place of supply would be location of the supplier. Then supply of services on board or a conveyance. Wherever the services are supplied on board or a conveyance, what would be the place of supply? We have seen in section 10 the supply of goods on board. Let us look at services supply on board. So if a service is supplied, vessel, aircraft, train or motor vehicle, the place of supply. Now, in case of a restaurant services, say food services, I have said the place of supply is wherever it is served. Imagine same on the train. A train starting from Delhi all the way to Bangalore. It has to pass through so many states. In between, some food is being served. Now, at the time of raising an invoice or booking the liability, you can't expect the person who is serving just peep out of the window, look at which station it is and which state it belongs to, right? It's very difficult. So whenever the services are provided on the board, especially you will find internet being made available. Wi-Fi data is given at 100 rupees per hour, whatever. So today, all this, on flight, you will be getting various other services also, restaurant services. Today, you will see some trains providing you a couple of beauty treatment services or health related services, anything service which is provided. So the place of supply in these situations is treated as what is the first schedule point of departure of that conveyance. Whatever is the first schedule point of departure of that conveyance, that is treated as place of supply. And the supply of goods will be dealt in section 10, not here. As I said, the place of supply will be wherever the goods are loaded on the conveyance. Hope this is clear. Moving on to 12 subsection 11, which is on telecommunication services. You know, let me give you one classic example. You are in Delhi. You have purchased a Airtel service, data card services, right? And your office is located in Noida, Uttar Pradesh. Every day you travel from Delhi to Noida, you will be using most of the time your phone in Noida. You have a connection, you are using it in Noida. Technically, you are getting the tower signals, communications, everything in Noida. At least 70% of the time you are using it in Noida. Now, when Airtel is raising an invoice to you, which should be the place of supply? You are consuming it in the state of Noida, but you are belonging it to Delhi. Even though connection you have taken in Delhi, but the services or the your receiver antenna signals are coming from Noida. So the question that may come up is, who is the state who should be treated as the place of supply? Because the place of supply is very important under GST. Whichever is the state treated as the place of supply, that state is going to get the revenue. So here again, the government has given carved out and given the basis for determining. In case of a landline, wherever the landline is installed. In case of postpaid, wherever the address is. In case of prepaid, if it is selling through a selling agent, Airtel will sell it to the agent, agent will further sell, whatever is the address of the selling agent. If it is any person, if it is by any person to a final subscriber, then wherever is the prepayment is received or vouchers that are sold. In any other case, there would be various other services provided by telecommunication services, and other than this, some VAS are provided, everything. So for all these cases, if the address of the recipient is available, that would be treated. If it is not available, the location of supplier would be treated. Now, you might have a situation where there are multiple connections. There are multiple connections. What do you mean by multiple connections? See, I have taken a lease line. I have taken a lease line and my lease line is located in multiple places. I have an office, say, in Karnataka, Bangalore, Chennai, Tamil Nadu, Bombay, Maharashtra. And I have taken one lease line from Airtel saying that on a VPN or dedicated 1:1 basis, all three offices situated. Consolidated, I have negotiated for a rent, for an annual rent of 5 lakhs. In such situation, what should be the place of supply? So, wherever these lease lines are installed in each state, I have to identify the contract. If the contract is not identifiable, then proportion to the value of services on whatever be the reasonable basis, that needs to be allocated. We are almost coming to the end. Then it comes to the banking services, 12 subsection 3. In case of a banking services, if the recipient is known, the place of supply is location of recipient. If the recipient is not known, the place of supply is the location of supplier, which is bank. Let's take an example. Bank of Punjab National Bank, situated in Punjab, Jalandhar as the place. I am from Gujarat. I have taken a loan to set up a unit in Gujarat. Now, say head office Jalandhar has sanctioned this loan. I am in Gujarat. Now, what should be the place of supply? What is the revenue this bank is earning? A is the loan processing charges and other things where the GST is being levied. In all these cases, the place of supply shall be the location of the recipient, which is Gujarat. Only when the recipient is not known, then the place of supply is whichever the bank which is serving. You may ask, is it possible that the bank do not know whom they are servicing? Definitely, in case of a customer who walks in and say takes a DD of 5,000 rupees, not necessary that the person should disclose who he is. In case of a DD, he just deposits 5,000 rupees and say commission of 50 rupees and tells that, okay, please take the DD in the name of chancellor, vice chancellor, Delhi University. So it is like that. So you do not know that who he is from. He might be from UP, Delhi or whatever. So wherever the bank is situated, that would be treated as place of supply. The last one coming up is insurance company services and advertising. So 12 subsection 13 deals with insurance services. This follows the principle same of 12 subsection 2. If it is provided to a registered person, then location of such person. If it is provided to an unregistered person, then the location of recipient of service. So wherever the recipient is, that would be treated as place of supply. In case of an advertisement services to central government, state government, then it has to be segregated to each of state and union territory. Take the classic case of this GST advertisement or the income tax advertisement. You may find on the DD or any channel on 15th of every quarter asking you to pay the advance tax by CBDT and advertisement is given. Now the contract of advertisement is given to one agency, that agency will bill it to CBDT. The question is, this is getting aired and across all the states, right? The GST, asking to pay GST is given all the states. So the benefit is being derived in all the states. So they say, if the contract is split, is available, identifiable, put it in each state. Otherwise, IGST rules have specified in the manner in which to segregate the contract. This is all about section 12. Which is domestic transactions for services. Then we will move to section 13, where the place of, please note here, the place of supply of services where location, where the supplier location or recipient location, either one party is outside India. If both the parties are outside India, absolutely there is no levy. Someone in foreign transaction doing something, we have nothing to do. Both the people are in India, so definitely it is an IGST or C plus S transaction, levy is there. But one person is in India, other person is outside India, it could be an export of services or it could be an import of services. It could be export of services or import of services. So for exporter and import of services, we have to fulfill the condition of export and import. Let's look at what is that. What is import of service? Import of service means 2 subsection 11 is supplier is outside India, recipient is in India, place of supply is also in India. If the place of supply is in India, only then it is import of service. Supplier is outside India, place of supply is outside India, recipient is in India, it is not import of services. Like this restaurant example, we have seen wherever you eat, it is the, that is a place of supply. You went to Singapore for a summit. In Singapore, you are having a food in a hotel. It doesn't mean that you are importing the that services into India. Supplier is in Singapore, recipient belongs to India, but the place of supply is outside India. Then let's look at export of services. Export of services means the supply of any service where supplier is in India, recipient is outside India, opposite to import. And the place of supply is outside India. The POS should be outside India. Very important, read the next two conditions. The payment for such services to be received by the supplier in convertible foreign exchange. It should be received by convertible foreign exchange. And the supplier of service and the recipient of services should not be merely an establishment of distinct person. It shouldn't be like head office and branch office. Then that will not be an export of services. Imagine a situation now. You are a hotel. You are a hotel or you are a restaurant. Someone from abroad is coming here into India. Someone from abroad is coming here into India. A foreigner has come. Supplier is located in India. Recipient is located outside India. The address of this foreigner is outside India. He is giving you, say, dollars. You charged him $100 per day. You charged him. That's the person has paid you $100. You got the forex also. Would it be export of service? Unfortunately, no. For it to be export of service, the place of supply should also be outside India. We know in case of hotel accommodation services, the place of supply is India. Again, the mistake that generally happens, is a lot of people who are treating a domestic transaction as export just because the person to whom it is served is outside India. Every time a supplier is in India and the recipient outside India doesn't make the transaction as an export transaction. We are going to see, and especially the mistakes are happening in case of an intermediary. Let's look at that. Now, even here, there is a general rule. The general rule is the place of supply for services, 13 subsection 2, in line with 12 subsection 2, the place of supply of services, except where the services which are specified in section 3, subsection 3 to subsection 13, shall be the location of recipients of services. So generally, the place of supply would be the location of recipient. Wherever the recipient is, that would be the place of supply. Now, if the location of recipient of service is not available, you do not know whom you are supplying to, then the place of supply is the location of supplier. Then the place of supply is location of supplier. Let's look at each of the sub rules, subsections, and what are the exceptions to this general rule, and identify whether it is an import or export or domestic transaction. Please note, this is a very, very important section, and people make mistake here and classify the transactions otherwise. Unfortunately, in GST, if a mistake is made, and this is going to be a costly mistake, if you held a transaction as an export which otherwise proved as a domestic transaction, general rate of services is 18%, you would end up paying 18% on your turnover, which is a costly mistake. So let's look at the all the subsections. First, a transaction where the service is happened on the goods made physically available. So someone has to do a repair work. Like goods is a goods, but repair work is a service. So whenever a service is supplied in respect of goods which are required to be made physically, and it has to be made available either by recipient of service or the supplier of service, or the person who is acting on behalf of the supplier of service, place of supply is the location where the services are actually performed. So assuming you are a mechanic, someone foreigner is bringing some goods for you to repair. Place of supply is where actually performed. There is a small exception which is carved out. The exception is if the services are provided from a remote location, so instead of goods coming to India, you are providing it from here remotely, wherever the goods are. If the goods are in India, then the place of supply is India. If the goods are outside India, wherever they are. Next, temporarily they are imported India for job work. You did the job work and you are sending it back. Temporarily imported in India for the job work. In that case, 13 subsection 2 would be applicable, where it will be treated as the outside India. Now you might be traveling. Here is an example. An electrical engineer located in India is deputed to undertake a repair work for a plant which is located in Singapore. So from India, you are traveling to Singapore and doing some repair work and installation, and you are coming back. The place of supply would be location of goods, that is Singapore. Next, 13 subsection 3, which we are continuing, we have looked at repair services to the goods. Next, individual services which are provided. If the services are supplied to an individual who is represented either as a recipient of services or person who is acting on behalf of it. So if some services are provided personally to an individual, then the place of supply is location where the services are actually performed. You as a doctor, you are going somewhere and doing a treatment and coming back. Wherever the treatment is done to an individual, that would be the place of supply. Or a doctor from abroad coming into India, doing a service and going back. It would be treated as an import of services because you are in India and the place of supply is in India. Very important. Most of the times people do not pay attention to import of services. The common mistakes that are happening here is a transaction where the place of supply is in India, it would be import of service. If it is an import of services under 5 subsection 3, you will have to pay as reverse charge liability, which is not paid. It would be a liability at a later date. Next, where the place of supply is in India, but you are still treating it as an export of services and not paying GST and claiming refund of input tax, the issue would be you will be paying back the refund with interest at a later date under section 73 or 74, and you will also pay up GST on the original transaction at the whatever the applicable rate along with the penalty and interest. So it is both the errors are happening in section 13, application of place of supply. Trust me, this chapter, the place of supply, is confusing, and as many times as you read, you may end up missing something. Every transaction, you definitely have to look into this specifically and apply. Next, 13 subsection 4 supplies in regards to immovable property. This is similar to 12 subsection 3. The place of supply is wherever the property is situated. wherever the property is situated, that would be treated as the place of supply. Now, I am here in India, traveling abroad to Singapore and staying in a hotel. I am paying to that hotel person. Would that become an import of service? The answer is no. Even though I am paying, say, forex or a foreigner, it will not become import of service because the place of supply is outside in India. A foreigner is coming into India. Hotelier is in India. Supplier in India. Recipient is outside India. And assuming this foreigner is paying in foreign currency, would it qualify as export of service? Answer is no, because the place of supply is in India. For export of service, the place of supply shall be outside India. That is not there. Next, performance-based service. Similar to 12 subsection 6 and 7, it could be with regards to an admission to an event or organization of an event. Admission to an event or organization of an event. The place of supply shall be wherever the event is actually held. Now, please note, I have given an example of a trade show coming up in Dubai earlier. Whenever a trade show coming up in Dubai earlier doesn't qualify it to be a transaction of Section 13 and treating it as a place outside India. For you to look into Section 13, you have to also fulfill whether the supplier or recipient is outside India. If both the parties are in India, you will not be referring to Section 13, you will be referring to Section 12. For you to refer to Section 13, either one of the parties should be outside India. In case of multi-place provision, so this is a specific entry which is given. If there is a place of supply which is there here in India, and it is you cannot identify to one location. It is more than one location in the taxable territory. The taxable territory is whole of the India, but the service is located to, service is supplied to more than one place. Then proportionate to each state, you have to identify the value and they apply the place of supply accordingly. It has to be proportionate to each of the state. Now you may ask, how do we do it? That is where we have to refer to the IGST rules. So 13 subsection 7, where the service referred to section 3, 4, 5 is supplied more than in one state or union territory, then the place of supply is attributable to value of such supplies to each union territory in proportion to the value of services collected or determined as per the contract. In the absence of such contract, any other basis as may be prescribed. Next, banking services. There is a slight departure with 12 subsection 12. In case of 12 subsection 12, we said the place of supply is location of recipient. But here, the place of supply in case of the following services. Three services. One, banking. Services supplied by a banking company to its account holders. Second, intermediary services. Third, services consisting of hiring of means of transport, including AHS and everything other, but it doesn't include aircrafts and vessels up to a period of 1 month, right? So in case of these services, the place of supply is location of supplier. And I would want to discuss on an intermediary services. Who is an intermediary? Intermediary is someone who is facilitating the trade. Assuming I am here in India. There is a machinery in Japan. Someone in India is looking for that machine. I am going to connect the buyer and the seller. seller in Japan is doing a direct transaction with the buyer, say in Kolkata. From Germany or Japan, the contract is directly done with the buyer in Calcutta. Who am I? I am the middleman facilitating the trade. I bill the supplier who is in Germany in the foreign currency, the commission is received. I am in India, person is outside India, foreign currency is received. Most of the people make mistake and treat this as export of service. Unfortunately, in case of an intermediary services, 13 subsection 8 clause B, intermediary services, the place of supply is the location of supplier. I am providing the commission, brokerage, intermediary services here from India, the place of supply shall be India. So here is where the mistakes happen. So X, which is located, whose intermediary in India, the place of supply would be in India. Then transportation services, 13 subsection 9 is relating to goods. Relating to goods is if there is transportation of goods are happening, wherever the goods are being given for destination. So the place of supply shall be destination of such goods. Unfortunately, we have seen in 12 where the transportation services of goods, where the goods are going outside, they have, like 13, they have also made it as place of destination of goods, but it is still does not qualify as export because both supplier and recipient are in here in India. But if the recipient is outside India or the supplier is outside India, the place of supply shall be destination of such goods. So if I'm paying a transportation charges to a foreign party, it would be treated as import of services, or a foreign transporter picking the goods here in India and taking outside India, it would be qualifying, it will not be treated, the place of supply would be an IGST transaction outside the purview of the GST because supplier is outside India. In case of a passenger transportation services, the place of supply would be wherever the passenger is embarking the conveyance for the journey. So wherever the passenger embarks, that would be treated as place of supply. And in case of the services which are provided on the conveyance, it could be any services, whatever is the first scheduled point of that conveyance, that would be treated as place of supply. Please note, this chapter is little dry, definitely I agree, and more than that, it is confusing because each subsection when you refer to, it talks about different place of supplies. It needs definite attention and multiple readings. Next, in case of an order, what is an order? Online information data exchange retrieval services. The place of supply is location of recipient. Wherever the recipient is, that would be place of supply. Now, what is an order services? See, through online, some service is provided. Now, how do I know recipient? The place of supply, I'm saying the recipient. How do I know recipient? There are multiple recipients. How do I know who they are, where they are? So they said, look at any two non-conflicting, non-contradictory following of the two, you pick it. Whichever those two destination is given, that would be treated as the location of recipient. If any of the following two are in India, place of supply is in India. If you find any of the two are outside India, then it would be outside India. What are the two? Do you know the address? Do you know the credit card, debit card which is used? Who has issued? What is the billing address? Or the IP address through which the service recipient is accessing, or the bank of the recipient of the services, the SIM or the landline which he has given as the communication address, which country it belongs to. Look at those things. If any of the two non-contradictory are satisfying, take that as the location of recipient. Now, 13 subsection 13, there is a proviso which is given, wherein to prevent a double taxation, like how we have a DTAA, double taxation avoidance agreement, even under GST, government has given a saving grace. that there can be a non-taxation of the supply of service for uniform application of the rules. Currently, there is no DTA agreement done at this point to any with any of the country, but there is a saving grace given. I will explain you in a while how can this come up. We will just look at it. So online information data access retrieval service, which is dealt in section 14, we will see how 1313 can also come here. First, let us understand what is an order. Order means services are either delivered or mediated over internet information technology, and the services are in such a nature that it is necessary that they need an internet, and the human intervention is very minimal. Like you only need the chat support to help choose the plan, but rest of the thing you go over internet and you buy. Please note, it is purchase of services, not goods. And generally, it could be advertising services, cloud services, e-books, movies, software, data access retrieval, whatever the kind of services. And it could be a simple thing. You have developed a small tool to calculate income tax, to calculate GST, to calculate loan moratorium period, and you have uploaded somewhere on the Play Store. Somewhere globally, someone would have clicked it and purchased it. These are your online information data access retrieval services. So in case of an order services, we have seen the place of supply is wherever the person is. Now, section 14 said, if the supply of order by a person who is located in non-taxable territory, when is non-taxable territory, is outside India. So there is the supplier is outside India. So this is section 14, not withstanding in section 13, whatever we read, section 14 specifically to a person who is outside India and received by a non-taxable online recipient. Who is a non-taxable online recipient? An unregistered person or an individual who is not registered, or a business person who is not registered, or a government. In these cases, the supplier of services who is located in non-taxable territory shall, please note, he shall be the person who is liable to pay IGST on supply of such services. So the same example which I said, you built a calculator, whatever, swap it. Someone in Australia has built some tool. He put it on the cloud. Someone who is here in India, a registered person, if they are downloading, it is an import of services, that person will pay. But if an unregistered person or a government organization is accessing that order services, then who is liable to pay? Such person who is outside India is liable to pay. Now you might be asking, how can the levy be someone who is outside India? Unfortunately, these are the laws. The place of supply is here in India, levy is applicable. I know there are a lot of companies who have registered only for the purpose of an order. Order has a separate registration, separate return filing thing. Every month they appoint a person here in India only for the purpose of payment of tax. They appoint a person and make the payment of taxes. So in these cases, the order is responsible. Now take a small example, Google. In Google Play Store, you find some good app. You download, you paid some money and you have downloaded it. Now in such situation, when the app is downloaded, the Google Ireland is responsible to pay the Indian GST. For some reason, if the Ireland do not allow it to be a export, and Ireland also demands to pay GST in that country, and that is paid here also, that is where the saving grace section 13, subsection 13 comes in, wherein there can be a treaty. But as of now, there is no such thing which has come up. But please note, in case of transactions where the order services is to a non-taxable online recipient, then the tax should be paid by the person who is providing such service. As I said, who is non-taxable online recipient? It is government, local authority, a government authority, or an individual any other person who is not registered. So those who are not registered are non-taxable online recipient. If any of these people are receiving the services, the order who is providing the service has to pay GST. So receiving order services in relation to any purpose other than commerce, industry or other business or profession located in taxable territory. Because commerce, industry, that person is registered, he would end up paying GST under a reverse charge basis. So we have almost come to the end. One item which I would want to tell about intermediary in case of an order. Sometimes there would, like Google Ireland, assuming if Google Ireland says that, look, I am not the one who is selling this software on the Play Store. Someone else is selling, do not levy GST on me. If something like this to happen, then firstly, the invoice or customer bill should be made available such way that intermediary is taking part in the supply. He is clearly identifying the service in the question, its supplier in the non-taxable territory, which means intermediary is saying the Google India or someone is saying that, look, I have got nothing to do. Someone outside in the non-taxable territory is doing it. And intermediary should not supply or authorize to charge, collect the money. Intermediary will not authorize to deliver. And the general terms and condition of supply are also not set by intermediary. Only in these cases, the intermediary can exclude himself out of the order. Otherwise, intermediary will become the order and he would have to pay. Definitely, one has to pay in case of an order services. It's just if someone is facilitating and doing everything through him, he is the one. If he wants to escape, then the original supplier should come in to step in and pay the GST on that transaction. The last of the provisions before we open the Q&A. This provision is not effective yet, but there is a provision which is there. Refund of IGST paid on supply of goods to a tourist who is leaving outside India. So whenever a foreign tourist coming into India, he is paying any GST. When he is going back outside India, when he is returning back outside India, he is eligible to claim a refund of IGST paid. Please note, it is applicable to only IGST paid on supply of goods alone. So what are the provisions of this? Section 15 says, if a tourist who is living in India purchasing any goods on which he has paid IGST and he is taking such goods outside India, then the IGST paid by such tourist on the goods would be refunded to him and the manner, condition, safeguard would be prescribed. Right now the procedure is not effective yet. What does the tourist means? The person who is not resided in India but he enters in India, stays up to 6 months, and the purpose of stay can be legitimate and non-immigrant purpose. So in such situation, whenever the goods he is taking back, please read the point number 3, whatever the goods he is taking back, to the extent goods he is consuming in India, there is no refund. To the extent which goods he is taking back, because taxes cannot be exported, so he is, the GST on such goods will be refunded to him. Please note, friends, these are the provisions of the place of supply. We have covered the transaction differentiating interstate and intrastate. We have also seen how the domestic transactions to be levied for goods in Section 10. What is import and export under Section 11 for goods? Supply of services, if both supplier and recipient is in India, is dealt in Section 12. Place of supply is where general thumb rule is location of recipient. The exception we have seen from 12.3 to 12.14. If either supplier or recipient, if any one of the party is outside India, then we have dealt it in Section 13. Friends, these are the broadly provisions of the place of supply. Common error that happens is in case of service, blindly section 12 subsection 2 is applied. Just because the recipient is out in a different state, IGST is levied, answer is no. Levy has to be done looking at the place of supply. in case of Section 13, common mistake happens is import of service is not considered or export of service is not, it is treated as export of service even the place of supply is in India. That's a common mistake. Next common mistake in services that happen is intermediary services. Intermediary services is place of supply is where the intermediary is located. That is again mistaken. When it comes to the goods, if the, even though goods are sold across the counter, but if the recipient gives his address in a different state and he is taking the goods, then the place of supply shall be the where the goods are moving to. The recipient is in that state. The delivery terminates to the recipient. That shall be the place of supply. Friends, these are the broad provisions of the place of supply and various issues that come up. So we are well within the time. We have just completed. We have hit that 5:30 mark. So with this, I conclude my session and we will open this floor to the organizers. Over to you, Akshay. If you have anything to add, please feel free to add. If something I have made any mistakes, if you feel that something needs to be corrected, added, please feel free to add it. Otherwise, we are open to any questions. And if you have any questions, clarifications, you can always write to me. So with this, I conclude my session and thanks to Hiragangi Academy and who have taken up this noble initiative of educating members during this COVID lockdown regime to upgrade their skills. And I'm sure all of you are safe at home and having good knowledge upgrade sessions. So over to the organizers, over to you, Akshay.
Thank you, Venu sir. Very informative session. I would like to add a few points.
Yes,
so first two points are in relation to high C sales and goods which are sold in from a non-taxable territory to a non-taxable territory. So both are covered under Schedule 3 item, which is not an activity as a supply of goods or services. I wanted to bring this in because these are transactions where the place of supply, although does not attract, people may have doubt on these issues. So correct. That's why I wanted to indicate that these will be a Schedule 3 items and not liable to GST. Next issue was in relation to Section 12(8), which is transport of goods for cases where the supplier and recipient are both within India. The proviso which says that when goods are sent to a destination outside India, the liability then becomes an IGST liability for the supplier. In such case, there was a slide which said that where the place of supply is not equal to the location of recipient, ITC is ineligible. So would it remain the same in such a situation?
Yeah, unfortunately, this is a question which has come up to many, where the till March 19 the transaction was the nil rate, September 19 it was a nil rated transaction. Then when the Amendment Act came into effective from the last year, that became an IGST transaction. And most of the cases, the moment the place of supply is not location of recipient, it becomes an ineligible credit and it is actually creating a loss of credit. And I'm sure this is something which is going to come up in the through the courts. It has to come to a rescue. Though the intention was to keep this transaction outside and make it as an exempt, but unfortunately this has come up by way of in Section 12, making it as an IGST, but definitely it is not an export. So there would be a credit loss in my view.
Okay, sir. Although I have heard alternative views on the credit aspect.
I agree. There are different experts have a different view, but that is where courts have to come.
Yes, sir. Okay, so next one, I wanted to include one point, which was in relation to export of services. The export definition was amended to include receipts in INR. In relation to the RBI guidelines, if you could add on that, sir.
Yeah. Okay. So we also had the circulars which have come, and especially when it came to the transactions with regards to the Nepal and Bhutan. Now, whenever the transaction is with Nepal and Bhutan, it is RBI also has permitted to receive the foreign currency instead of foreign currency in INR. So even though the currency is received in INR, it would be treated as if it is export. That is one of the thing one has to keep in mind. Then we have another circular which has come up, which is circular number 78. With regards to the export of services where the full consideration has not been received, and very important circular one has to make note of, it might so happen that I have undertaken a transaction say in Singapore, and instead of me executing the transaction, I have subcontracted to someone in Singapore. And to my customer, I have asked him, you remit the part money to him, remit the balance money to me. In these cases, even though I did not receive the full money, can it be treated the part consideration foreign currency received? Would it be permitted? Again, the circular clearly said this would qualify as an export of services, and under the RBI general or specific approval, even the part consideration is received, it would be treated as export of services.
Yes sir, next issue is in relation to section 1313. So there was a notification 4/2019 integrated tax rates, which gave a relaxation in relation to pharma sector where they do research and development activities. Where goods are provided to India, but the services are provided to a person who is outside India. So in these cases, they have said that for the benefit of these industries, they are considering these activities as export of services and specifically made the place of supply as outside India.
Correct. We have covered almost the entire notification itself, 4/2019. So this was also like a relief thing to prevent the double taxation or the non-taxation of the supply of service. So the thing is, the supply with regards to the research and development of the pharmaceutical. Now the thing which they have said is the place of supply shall be the location of recipient, and the supply of services shall be from taxable territory. So the research and development activity should happen in India, and as per a contract between the service provider who is in India and the recipient should be outside India. So if the supply services fulfills all other conditions of the export of service except the clause 3, everything it would be treated as an IGST transaction. So this was also a relief which is given to pharma who is just involved in because technically they are providing a formula and everything. So they have identified various different types of sectors where this benefit would be given. Basically research, biological entities who are doing an animal and modes of disease, or evaluation of new chemicals or metabolisms or toxology, some stability. These are the clinical trials which has been given. So they gave a notification to give relief to pharma sector, treating this as an export of services. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. So now I'll get into the questions which have been shared. So first question is by Mr. Pratik. So taxable person is a freelancer in Mumbai who has a page on his Facebook. The Facebook page share of advertisement which is given to him on a monthly basis in Forex. So here they're asking what would be the place of supply.
Okay, so now I have given an advertisement. So firstly, now you have to look at it. Who is the supplier and recipient? So firstly, this is a service. So it is section 12 and 13, not 10 and 11. So the next question to ask is whether it is 12 or 13. For it to qualify as 13, either one party should be outside India. You are in Maharashtra, so definitely you are in India. whether the recipient, who is the Facebook, who is consuming, who is you are providing advertisement the services on the Facebook platform because of you, so Facebook is gaining some traffic and they're paying you some consideration. Now Facebook, when they're giving you some consideration for whatever be the activity which you have done, so the Facebook, there is an India entity, there is a Facebook foreign entity with whom you have entered into a contract. It is definitely, there would be a contract. You cannot say that there is no contract because you would have entered an online some terms and condition. So in your case, you have mentioned that you are getting some Forex. In your case, you have mentioned that you are getting Forex. So when you are receiving some Forex and the person is outside India, in my view, you have satisfied the definition of export of services, which means the supplier is in India, recipient is outside India, place of supply is outside India. How did you fulfill place of supply India? Outside India, general condition, the location of recipient of services. So you have fulfilled that condition, and in this transaction would be treated as an export in my view.
Sir, so the next question, question is, it's a long
will
question.
The questions be visible to me? Can it come up on the screen? Anything?
Yes, sir. So on the right side, there's a questions option. There's one window with a small window. Yeah. So you can click on the showed answered questions. So you will be able to view only the ones which are not answered.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yes, sir. So now we are in the question which reads as, query is relation to place of supply of services. Facts being A & Co. Private Limited is an Indian subsidiary of A & Co. Inc. USA. Nature of services of Co. Inc. USA engaged in the provisions of computerized embroidery designs, emblems and artworks for various clients in India. A & Co. outsources various design support services and back office services to A & Co. Private Limited for serving the same to Indian customers of A & Co. Inc. USA. Amount received by A & Co. Private Limited from the USA entity is cost plus markup in foreign currency. So query here is whether the services given by A & Co. Private Limited is an export of service.
Okay. So the if you need, look at the explanation to section 8, or if you look at the definition which I said on export of the condition to fulfill on export of services. So one exception which I have mentioned is the supplier of services and recipient of services are not merely establishment of a distinct person, which means if it is a transaction between a head office and a service, it will not qualify as an export of services. In your case, you have mentioned it as A & Co. Private Limited in India and A & Co. Inc. USA, which is a holding company and a subsidiary. Holding company and a subsidiary is different from head office and a branch office. I see the question from Agarwal Pankaji. In my view, this is an export of services. It qualifies as an export of service.
Okay, sir. We'll move on to the next question. From Manoj Agarwalji, my office is located in West Bengal and my client is from Sikkim. He comes to my shop, pays me cash, takes goods by their own transport. Bill is addressed to Sikkim. Place of supply will be Sikkim and it is interstate sale. But how to prove to proper officer that it is interstate sale? Where the value of supply is less than 50,000, no e-way bill also is required. So no transport documents, no money received in bank. Please throw some light on place of supply relating to X factory basis.
Yeah, sir, Manoj Agarwalji, the onus of proving to the proper officer, generally I see only in section 155 where the input tax credit is claimed. But however, your point is valid. The section 10, it says the address on record. So As far as the invoice which you are issuing, you have specifically given the address as Sikkim. You are in West Bengal and you have given the Sikkim address. So it clearly indicates the person has come from Sikkim and purchased it. It would become an IGST transaction. I think that itself is sufficient evidence, and nothing more is required in my view.
Okay, sir, got it. We will go
actually,
to the
in case if you want to add anything further also, you can feel free to add in spite of me sharing. Yeah,
sure, sure, sir. So then the next question is in relation to place of supply relating to X factory basis. I think here they are trying to link between the previous excise regime and GST.
Yeah, so that's all. The moment after GST coming in, so the old laws we have to definitely somehow unlearn. It is still the place of supply. You have to look at it where the goods moved. So it is outside your state. So whether you are taking it, someone is coming and taking it, still it will become an IGST transaction.
Okay, sir, got it. Next question is, why GST credit reflecting on bill of entry should not reflect in GSTR 2A?
Yeah, sir, if you look at it, GSTR 2A, it has three parts. Part A is a forward charge credit, which is auto-populated from GSTR 1, table 3, 4, 5, reverse charge, forward charge, and credit note credit. Then part B, you have ISD credits. Part C is TDS and TCS credits. The credit which is on IGST, which is in bill of entry, it has got nothing to do with 2A. It cannot come in 2A. Because the tax is collected by the port authorities, customs port. So you would have to pay the GST on yourself and claim it as an import of goods under 4A1. So you would be paying to the customs. You would have to pay, take the credit. The only way to check is in the IceGate portal. You enter the bill of entry and the port code. You will be seeing the consignment details.
Okay, sir. Next question is, the place of supply in case of goods which are required to be assembled, whether this condition is to be seen from supplier side or from customer side too. So he means if customer only purchases and says that he will assemble and install, which he'll assemble and install himself or through some other person, still will it be considered under the same clause of place of supply?
Yeah, Abhayji, the answer to it is you have to look at it from the supplier side. So if the supplier is undertaking the responsibility of delivering the equipment at your side, you have to see. If the supplier is giving the goods and the recipient is doing the installation by himself, then you will be applying 101A and you will be only looking at the levy from the 101A where the goods are moving. In this situation, since the assembly is not undertaken by the supplier, so you will not apply the rule of assembling at the supplier side. That would not be applicable to you.
Okay, sir. Next question regarding the restatory provision when both the recipient and supplier are in the same in India. We know his place, that is he is registered person from other state, how can we charge IGST because supply happened in home state?
I did not understand.
Naveen Kumar ji is trying to ask, so if I am a registered person from Karnataka and if the okay, so I think what he's trying to ask is where the supply has happened in the home state, which is say in Karnataka, but the person who is a registered person who is from another state.
Okay.
So how can we charge IGST in such scenario? Should it not be CGST, SGST is what I think the question is.
Yeah, I get your question. In fact, there was one interesting advance ruling, which I think I would want to discuss here. This is in case of Vishakara Prashant Bhave Micro Instruments, which is the case of Maharashtra. There they have said in it is an intermediary services, whether it was falling as export of services. So they said no, it is not export of services. So then they said, would it be would this transaction, okay, if it is not export of services, what would be the place of supply? Is it going to be they are basically from Maharashtra, would it be Maharashtra as the place of supply? And the advance ruling authority said that, okay, this is an under IGST purview, the place of supply would be IGST. Here, the supplier is in Maharashtra, the place of supply is Maharashtra, but it was said as IGST transaction. How can it happen? So if you notice, while filing your GST return, you have GSTR1, the place of supply drop down, and each state has a state code. Here you will be using the state code 97. It will by default make it as IGST, and it will become an IGST transaction. This is what most of the times you are seeing under 12 subsection 8. The transporter cases where the goods have been exported, the transporters are now using the state code 97 and making this transaction as an IGST transaction.
Sir, I think the question what he's asking is where the supply is happening in one state, that is, yeah, like a retail supply, if you take.
Is it for goods or service?
As of now, I think they are mentioning services. So they're saying that where the person is, he is known, so they know the person, but he's registered in another state. Okay. But the supply has actually, the physically supply has taken place in another state. So in this case, based on the residuary provision, that is the location of recipient, how can we charge IGST? So what he's trying to mention is the services has been consumed in another state, but the tax is moving to a different state. So how is that taking place is what I think is the question.
See, the law is clear. The services consumed might be another state, say the restaurant services. A person from a different state has come to my state and consumed. The revenue should go to other state is a general provision. But if in the specific provisions they say the place of supply is in my state, then that particular provision also provision only has to be applied. So we can't question the destiny based or principle based thing here. Maybe I think he can come up with an example in specific rather than speculating. We are trying to speculate the question. I think we can move on to the next one.
So yes. So the main requirement here is that it should be specific service should be understood to understand the place of supply. So next question is, in the build to ship to model, is there two transactions, that is supplier to third person and third person to recipient?
Yeah, there are two transactions. So on my instruction, supplier has given it to, say, my customer. So supplier will bill me, I will bill the customer, but goods will not move to me, but there are definitely two transactions.
Yes, sir. Next question, as per section 10(1)(a), place of supply is location of goods at the time at which the movement of goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. In your example of Delhi supplier and Mumbai recipient, so the question is,
only, so I understood again, across the counter when the supply happens. So I still said the Delhi supplier and the Mumbai recipient, I said the place of supply is Mumbai. Yes, Priyanshji, it is definitely the place of supply is Mumbai, because if you look at the provisions, the place of shall be location of the goods at the time at which the movement of the goods terminates for delivery to the recipient. You may say that across the counter I have given the delivery to the recipient terminated there. The answer is no, the recipient is further taking the goods till Mumbai. So the delivery to the recipient is terminating in Mumbai. So the place of supply would be Mumbai.
Sir, here I would like to add one point. There is this concept of risk and rewards being passed on. So risk and rewards are passed on at X factory basis. So that means once it is removed from my showroom premises or my factory premises, I hold no title, possession or risk or rewards towards such goods. So my movement to him is completed, and his movement after that is up to him. Whether he moves it or does not move the goods is up to his wish. So there was a discussion on this, that the movement which is mentioned, movement of goods, there are two movements, one from the supplier to the recipient and another by the by the recipient himself. So from that nature, a clause in the terms and conditions of the invoice can be mentioned, which says that the movement in relation to the supply ends at the factory premises, and they may be able to charge CGST and SGST.
See, I believe that this would defeat the purpose and intention of the law, because the consuming state should get the benefit of the taxes. Because if you look at 101A, it says supply involving the movement of goods, whether by the supplier or by the recipient. So they are also envisaging the recipient is picking the goods and coming. So if I have to give a small example, I am here in Bangalore. A customer in Chennai asking the goods. So I am sending the goods to Chennai. I will be charging IGST. Instead of he asking me to deliver, I say that I do not know how to deliver. So I have, instead of me delivering, I have engaged a VRL and delivered. It will still be IGST. If I don't even know VRL, so the person in Chennai is sending someone to pick the goods to Chennai, still an IGST. He himself is coming and picking and going, it would be an IGST. So in my view, it would be an IGST transaction.
Yes, sir. I agree. Most of your examples I am agreeing to. The only issue where the person does not have an address, for example.
Then definitely it will fit under where there is no address. If the address is not there, then it is deemed that is consuming in my state. The place of supply will be my state.
Okay, sir. Got it. I just wanted to bring this out.
So, yeah, good point.
Yes, sir. So the next one is in relation to the subletting provision of property. So what will be the place of supply where you do a renting of a space or stall in a mall for few hours or a day, which is taken on rent? Here there is no agreement made for both transactions. So will it fall under section 12(3) of in relation to immovable property?
Yeah, so subletting would feel under 12(3) only. So wherever the property is, it would be applicable. That would be the place of supply.
Yes, so the next question is, recipient is causing movement of goods, then movement of goods will be terminated in Delhi. I think it's the same question as earlier. Yeah, so we will move on to the next one.
Yeah.
In relation to place of supply, where the property is in Noida and supply and recipient register in Delhi, isn't it mandatory to register for supply in different state?
Yeah, so Pratik ji, on a lighter note, this is an out of syllabus question. So this is a registration chapter. However, I am of a personal view that just because there is a property in Uttar Pradesh, I need not register in Uttar Pradesh, and I can still have my registration in Delhi and make an IGST invoice. See, the property being Uttar Pradesh makes the place of supply as Uttar Pradesh. Anywhere dispute on it. Just because the place of supply is in another state doesn't make it mandatory to register in that state, unless otherwise I am making a supply from that state, if I leave from the section 22. And assuming this is a property which is there in that state and I have no control, I have given it to, say, a big mall, I have given it for rent. Now, I do not supervise, I do not maintain it, I do not take care of it. If it is my property, I should also put my registration certificate and everything. Once I have given it for let out, the tenant will not allow me to use it for my premises. So I personally feel having registration in that state is not required. See, in any case, there is no revenue loss. The revenue is still flowing to that state only because the place of supply is that state.
Yes, sir. I also have answered similarly. Yeah. Next question also, I think, is in the is same.
Yeah.
So we'll move on to the next one. Please clarify in your example why ITC is not available for to architect from Delhi who is staying at a hotel in Bangalore.
Right. So whenever the place of supply is different from location of recipient, ITC is not available. Because what is ITC? It is as good as credit I'm borrowing from the my state. In case of a place of supply in Bangalore, the revenue has been collected by state of Karnataka, but the input tax credit is being taken from Delhi. So both do not match. Now you may ask this question that it is not my headache. The plain reading of the law, if you see the section 16, the registered person, you may say you are the registered person. I would read it as registered person in that state to claim the refund, like the Delhi GST Act, Delhi registered person. So for a benefit of input tax credit of Karnataka to be available, it would be available to my distinct person. I am here in Delhi. It would be available to the person in Karnataka and not to me. That's my view. And that's how you will not get the input tax credit.
Yes, sir. Agreed. Next question is, they want you to repeat section 75C, Rajiv Keshav.
Yeah, so section 75C is it only 7 subsection 5 clause C is in respect to the we have one is goods domestic, 2 goods imported, 3 services, 4 services imported. 5 it says that when the within the geographically you are in the taxable territory, but you are making supply to an SEZ, it is deemed there. And the last clause, which is carved out, saying that if it is not an intrastate supply and not covered elsewhere, it will become an interstate supply, which is more like a saving clause that you have a transaction which did not fit anywhere and you want to apply what is the supply, whether inter or intra, then it becomes an interstate supply. So it is more like a saving clause, and you can apply the same thing to that Vishakara example also. They have applied and said, if you do not find anything specific thing, it becomes an interstate supply. Yeah.
Okay, sir. So it's already 6 o'clock now. So we'll just take another 2-3 questions, and then the balance, if there are any, we will
reply to them.
Yeah, we'll respond through the email.
Yes.
So next question is in relation to the where the place of supply and the location of service is Bangalore, but the recipient is in Delhi, whether we need to mention the GSTN of the Delhi person in the invoice.
Yes, mentioning of GSTN of that person is mandatory, and it is mandated in Rule 46 also. When you look at your 2A, you will get these line items in your 2A. Just because this line item is there in 2A, it doesn't give you a necessary credit. Though little deviation to the subject, what is the eligible credit you have to get is, if you look at GSTR 9 table 8 clause A, has some credit value. Now most of the time you try to match this value with the 2A. So from 2A, the GSTN has carved out what are the eligible entries to you. So they have removed the reverse charge, they have removed place of supply not belonging to state, they have removed the amendment invoice, the credit notes negative, all those adjustments are done and it was done. So just to answer, yes, then it is necessary to print the GSTN in the invoice and upload it in GSTR1 also.
Yes, sir. So the next question is, if you can give an example of section 101C.
Okay. So I thought we have given the, where the supply is happening. So this is with respect to section 10, where we have the supply which is happening, but in movement of the goods are not there. I think I've given an example of the higher charges given. For example, say I am in the business of selling laptops, and in for one of my client, I did not sell the laptop. He has asked me for rent, and he has taken the laptop on rent. When the laptop is being taken on rent, I am not supplying the laptop. There is a movement of the goods, but supply is not happening. Laptop is with him. He is using it. Maybe a month later, he says, okay, I would want to buy this laptop. At that time, I will raise an invoice for the laptop. Till that point, it is supply of service, rental. At that time, when I raise the supply invoice for laptop, there is no movement of goods. But what is the place of supply? The place of supply, I shall be treating where the location of goods at the time the delivery to the recipient. So wherever the location of goods are there, that I should be using the place of supply. Earlier, assuming if the goods are moved to Tamil Nadu, and now I from Karnataka, I'm raising an invoice, even though there is no movement, it doesn't fit under 10 money, there is no movement. So I should be treating wherever the location of goods are there at that time.
Yes, sir. So we'll go to the last question for today. So please advise on taxability of Book My Show tickets issued for music performance shows by an artist or band which are held in multiple cities across India.
Okay. Okay. So now this is a question on kind of an internet related services. Now let's understand. What is the contractual arrangement between Book My Show and the supplier of services? Is Book My Show a merely an intermediary providing and facilitating collection activity, or is Book My Show a buyer and undertaking a buying and selling of transaction? For example, I am doing a performance and I am doing a show and I have raised an in, I have given, put it under Book My Show, and Book My Show is further selling. For me, first I have to see what is my the supply. Generally, in case of Book My Show, what I understand is Book My Show is going to, whatever the tickets which have been sold, it would be more like a back-to-back. Book My Show is going to raise an invoice to the customer for the transaction, and they will take their commission and they will pay me. And custom based on the ticket, the people are coming to my concert and attending. What is my place of supply? I have received the money. The place of supply in this case is wherever the person, wherever my show is being conducted, that would become the place of supply. So I have to look the transaction, because I have done the show in Bangalore. I should be treating the place of supply under section 12, subsection 6, wherever the show entry has been given to them. So that would become the place of supply wherever the event is held.
Yes, sir. I have also answered similarly. There are many other questions which are there, which we will respond to the directly to their email IDs.
Yes.
So we will close the session for today. I would like to thank all the attendees for staying patient and giving us so many good questions, and also would like to thank Venugopal sir for conducting this session on place of supply. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Academy. Thank you.